There are many factors that contribute to our overall health and well-being. These can include things like exercise, sleep, sense of satisfaction, sense of meaning and purpose, and how one feels their life is going. A holistic definition of well-being can be described as a blend of physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual aspects. In a study of employed Australians that McCrindle conducted with Reventure, the majority of employed persons identified well-being as when I have found balance across my physical, mental, social, and spiritual life. It's also pretty evident to us, though, that people's personal well-being has taken a bit of a hit in recent years. More than one in six Australians say they have never felt part of a flourishing community, and around the same number say they often feel lonely. Additionally, more than half of Australian teen and 20-somethings say they're living with a long-term mental health condition such as anxiety or depression, and less than half of this age group report strong satisfaction in their life in measures such as sense of purpose, contentment, personal growth, and spiritual well-being. So even though these are some pretty staggering statistics, we thought we would look at in today's episode some other insights that we've conducted with regards to faith and spirituality and where this is all headed. So joining me today to do that is social researcher Jeff Braley. Jeff, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ashley. It's great to be here and yeah, love the topic. So looking forward to today's convo.
As I tried to sort of allude to in the introduction, you know, faith and spirituality is really key to our overall sense of well-being. We talked about that in the Work Wellbeing book that we wrote. We also touched on it in the Generation Alpha research that we conducted. I guess, Jeff, I wanted to just ask you if you feel comfortable sharing with our listeners whether you personally have a faith and how much that has an impact on your day-to-day life.
Yeah, thanks for asking. And yeah, I certainly do. And I've been a Christian since I was about 12 years old. I grew up in a Christian home. But I guess a part of my journey was that I actually got run over by a car when I was 7 years old. I got dragged down the street for about 40 meters while I was stuck under the car. My backpack caught under the car. I was doing the right thing, though. I was walking on the footpath on a rainy day coming home from school. And yeah, it certainly was one of those near-death experiences. And over the last 30 years, I think I'm 37 now, and those blurry years. But I certainly have thought a lot about life and mortality, and I love watching shows about mortality or immortality, even like thinking about Lord of the Rings and elves and a lot of different types of shows that have ageless beings. And I think that's something that personally I really have been drawn to, partly because of those sort of tragic circumstances. I've got a few extra scars that I wouldn't like on my body, and probably up in the brain box there as well. Certainly had a few challenging nights getting to sleep as a little kid, a bit afraid. Yeah. And I think for me, it was something that made me think about life and purpose and why I'm here. And I remember being in high school doing physics, thinking about the universe and the laws of nature and, well, I call it creation, but the laws of how the universe holds together. And it made me think, well, was there someone behind all this? And for me, that's where the Christian faith's been a really strong way for me to see the world. And I think that's probably the key point I'd make in talking about religions, talking about different spiritual outlooks. It's all about a world view. It's the way we see the world. And it's really fascinating to have the new data from the census that shows in Australia we've got 43.9% of Australians identifying as Christians, people who see the world using that lens as their way of observing life, death. It's how we interpret everything. And so I think when we talk about the different faiths, the different religions, and in Australia, we've also got 38.9% of Australians that say, I'm not associated with any religion. So there's this real dichotomy of ways we see the world, the ways we interpret and make interpret circumstances, the ways we make decisions, the way we spend our money, the way we view community. And certainly not about dichotomies here, but it's certainly a divergent approach to interpreting and seeing life. So it's a great topic. I'm stoked to talk about it today.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. And thanks for sharing that part of your own journey. I've heard that before, being a colleague of yours for a number of years, and it's incredibly, I guess, sobering in terms of hearing that experience that you had. And it makes total sense as to how that impacts your outlook on life and everyday living. And I too have a personal faith, and it does impact a lot of the decisions I make and the values that you mention and how I choose to live my life. So yeah, it's a big part of, I guess, society, which is why as social researchers, we are really interested in it. And you mentioned there even the percentage of Australians who identify as Christian and the latest census results, which we have analysed and you have been on the podcast to share about before. Jeff, we know Australia is transforming. What does the census tell us in terms of religious identification, even beyond just that sort of stat about the declining proportion of Australians identifying with the religion of Christianity?
Yeah, it's, I think, really interesting time. And it's even the question you use, I think, is an appropriate one. What's your personal faith? We've shifted a bit away from what we might have called cultural faiths, where particularly for cultural Christianity, there's been a decline of people who didn't practice the faith, but might have ticked that census box in the past censuses. And so that's declined by almost 9%. It was down from 52%, so down to 43% now. And that's really, I think, probably one of the biggest changes. And to be honest, I'm surprised it didn't drop further. The Christian brand has been slammed over the last 5-10 years. There's been royal commissions into child abuse. There's been some really challenging messages about the institution of the church. And I think for the listeners here, I'm aware there'll be people of all different faiths listening. And so I think for understanding that big shift in society is that there's still a strong cohort of Australia's population, 43%, that are identifying as Christian. Out of a population of 25 million people, we've got almost half there. So over 10 million people identifying with that Christian faith, despite it having had a really difficult brand experience over the last few years. And I think that's because it's a local, personal experience, as you even used in that question before. And so as a member of a local church, I think I really enjoy the people I connect with. I enjoy the worship service, that experience, that sense of being part of something bigger than myself, something that speaks to the metaphysical, the things beyond what we can just see and know. And I really enjoy pondering about those bigger questions of life. Why am I here? What's the meaning? And so what happens after death? All those types of questions, they're part of, I think, each faith would be speaking to those trends. And so it's an interesting period. And the other kind of key comment I'd make on the census results is that there was a slightly smaller group of people who actually ticked, I'm not going to answer this question. So it declined from 9.6% back in the 2016 census down to 7.3%. So there's slightly fewer people who haven't kind of made up their mind or feel comfortable sharing about it in the census. And so we've got the that growing group of people who tick no religion is probably one of the other key areas to chat about. But certainly there are other religions, Islam, Hinduism, and they've both been growing over this last 5-year period, where it's been stable for our Buddhist community. And there are other religions that people tick in that survey response question as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for painting that picture for us. We know from the census that Australia is incredibly culturally diverse, and that proportion who have at least one parent born overseas at 48%, or even the 27% of Australians who themselves are born overseas, has sort of been increasing over the last few censuses, over time. Do you think this increasing cultural diversity is playing directly into that greater religious diversity that we're seeing play out in these results?
Yeah, I think so. And we've in Australia shifted from the European migration, and that has had if we think back at the forming years of the colonies of New South Wales, recognising the Indigenous peoples who have lived here for thousands of years. But as Anglos settled on these shores and brought the Christian faith with them, it was a mix of Catholic, Protestant, sort of blends of the Christian faith, and certainly some pretty strong early opinions. I've been doing a bit of reading about the early faith experiences of communities in Australia, and so pretty strong cohorts, because you had the Irish rebelling against the Protestants, so the Catholic versus Protestant narrative was quite a strong experience back then. Whereas our migration today, we've shifted away from that Anglo migration into European, but even more so into an Asian century of migration. We've got the Hindi community, the Indian born fastest growing community in Australia. We've got certainly, I think, that shift of Asian migration. So we might have the Filipino community with their Catholic upbringing influencing migration, whether it's through to mainland China, some traditional views there of religion, traditional religions, but also I think a cohort that would probably tick the no religion box as well. So certainly I think in this era of Asian migration in Australia, we're going to continue to see a range of spirituality and religious outlooks. And I think for some, that's actually probably helping that Christian percentage stay and didn't decline as much because with all religions, countries like Korea, we've got a strong Christian community in the Korean population. So I think that will continue to probably balance and stabilize a variety of religions, but it's certainly in some ways helping Christianity, but also there are growing religions like Sikhism and Islam in Australia.
Yeah, absolutely. And we definitely saw that coming through the census results. I think with when we talk about, we have the privilege at McCrindle and as social researchers to sort of dig deeper into a whole bunch of different topics. It's changing every day. And I think a lot of the team here love that sort of variety. But I think about the census and I think about that one question that is asked in the census about what is your religion? And even your reflection, I think just then, Jeff, on, you know, I guess British colonization of Australia, that very sort of Protestant Christian religion, so to speak, not to say that people who identify with that aren't spiritual, but compared to say something like sort of Australia's Indigenous people who are an incredibly spiritual people and have incredibly spiritual practices, even the word religion and spirituality are interesting kind of different ways to think about a similar topic. And I guess we've only got one question in the census about something that's incredibly personal and deep that maybe some people have addressed for themselves and others prefer not to. We've done a few studies that dig deeper into this topic among many others. What can you tell us, Jeff, about some of the studies that we have conducted at McCrindle around faith and spirituality and what that's revealed about the Australian people today and in the previous years?
Yeah, we as social researchers love asking questions about what I use phrases like what people want to learn and earn. What do people want to spend their money on? Where do people want to spend their time? And so studying the faith or religions or spirituality of people is certainly something we really enjoy doing because it actually gets to the heart of the matter for many Australians when you find out their religious affiliation. Even that one question, while it isn't very broad, it still gives a really interesting insight into that person. And so our communities, our states, our generations, we can see we've got an increasingly it's a stable group amongst the younger generations, but the 45% of our younger generations tick the no religion box. So what looks like a generation that don't want to have anything to do with religion are actually still really interested in spirituality. And so we've done studies over I've been here 7 years, and just about since day one I've seen studies around how society views religion, spirituality, where do we learn about spirituality, who influences us, even through to thinking about what impact did COVID-19 have on our spirituality. We were thinking more about mortality because we were facing those. Do you remember seeing those 11 a.m. in New South Wales? We were getting the 11 a.m. updates from Premier Gladys at the time, Gladys Berejiklian, who was giving us the daily death rates, the numbers of deaths from COVID. So people were thinking about their own mortality. People were opening up their Bibles more. We asked questions about that. People were spending more time praying than before COVID. So the impacts of a global pandemic, over a million deaths from COVID. And so certainly the circumstances have shaped our spirituality, our religious outlook, that worldview. Again, I think we've, in some ways, our society hopefully will be the better for having gone through something that's made us pause. We were forced to slow down. We were forced to be a bit more reflective. We had time on our hands to think, to read, to pray, to ask those big questions of, am I living the life I wanted to live and making it count? Because we all only get one shot. And so I think it's certainly, I think that's a little Hamilton reference. It's just slipped out there.
If you know, I appreciate song, that. So. I do.
It's interesting, isn't it? The music we listen to, the art we appreciate, it all gives us an eye into that window of the soul. And so I think COVID's been really fascinating. And if someone wants to shoot me an email, I'd be very happy to send through some of the reports that we've done on faith, spirituality, even church. We did a whole study on the future of church during 2020 because it was one of those first times in the history where it wasn't just Christianity, but every religion couldn't practice those important in-person sacraments, traditions, rituals. And so that had a big impact on faith communities, which is a huge part of society. It was one of the big learnings I think the government took away was if we're going to implement policies like this, we better know who to speak to understand what are we asking of communities as we make these changes. And so I think there's been a lot of learnings about religious intelligence, as we have probably heard about things like emotional intelligence. We've used phrases like generational intelligence, cultural intelligence. But I think as we go forwards in society, we're going to need to develop some religious intelligence, which is all about learning about the different faith cohorts in our community. They're your neighbours, they're the people on the bus. It's everyone around us in some ways. And I think understanding even why someone might tick no religion on that census box. We asked a question in one of our most recent studies, just saying, why do you think that about religion? And it was because people prefer a scientific view of life. And so instead of having that spirituality, something you can't see and can't prove, it's sort of saying, well, I'll prefer to have something that I can rely on the facts and the science. So it's really fascinating of all the different positions people hold to understand why and explore how that impacts the way we shop, the way we learn, the way we work, the way we spend our free time. What do we do on the weekends? And for me on a Sunday, it's going to church. I love doing it, kind of grown up doing it and always have. And I hope I always do enjoy it. It's certainly been a great experience so far in my journey.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you mentioned there, Jeff, again, the census and some of the insights that I think about, you know, if we compare the 2016 results to the 2021 results that have only been released this year, Christianity dropped from 52.1% to 43.9%, so dropped below 50% for the first time, and no religion increased from 30% in the previous census to 38.9%. So they were some of the big adjustments. And as we mentioned, when you ask someone about what is your religion, if they're not practicing something, if they're not going to church or reading texts from whatever that religion might be, I think we can assume that people aren't thinking about spirituality or open to maybe engaging with that. And that's where I appreciate in one of our studies, we asked about people's sort of religious identification or attitude towards spirituality. And we included an option that said, I have spiritual beliefs, but I don't identify with any religion. So again, kind of getting the nuance that the census doesn't really have the time or the capacity to sort of go into. And I really appreciated, like you mentioned, even just hearing about people who don't identify with any religion, what they believe, or those who are spiritual but not religious, what they believe. So I think that it's very nuanced there. We also asked some questions about people's openness or attitudes towards spiritual conversations, because when you just look at those key stats where Christianity is declining as the two main respondent answers, Christianity is declining, no religion's increasing, it does paint that picture that people aren't open to it. But our study sort of proved otherwise. What did you find interesting about where people are at with regards to having some conversations maybe with those that they trust about these deep personal things?
Yeah, and it's that mix, isn't it, of a faith might be a very personal thing. And I think if we think of the older generations in Australia who might have had that European Christian upbringing and then maybe kind of didn't practice it very much, or as some of their experiences were a bit negative and a bit of hypocrisy, a bit of negativity towards that faith. Maybe they've stopped wanting to talk about it. However, that's not true for younger generations who maybe live in a slightly more culturally diverse era. So they might have different faith communities in their classroom of their friends, their mates, the birthday parties they're going to. And so I think we're learning a little bit more about it, but also open to talking about it as younger generations. So one of the big questions we asked in a recent study was around, are you open to having a spiritual conversation with someone that has a different view to your own? And almost half of Australians are open to that, extremely or very open to that spiritual conversation. And so while it's sort of a bit of a personal and private topic, I think when there's trust, when there's a friendship, when there's a relationship, people are happy to chat. And I think that's the encouraging thing, that Aussies are learning how to build relationships with neighbours, with co-workers, learning that there's special days of significance, whether it's Ramadan for an Islamic person, or whether it's the Easter period for a Christian, or Christmas Day for Australians is sort of a topic that probably most people will enjoy the day off. But maybe as we learn to understand that while there's a lot of Christian influence and history shaping some of the public holidays, there'll be other days of significance for other faith communities that we need to learn about. And I think the beauty of this age is that we can just quickly do the Google search on our phone and learn a little bit to inform what questions we should ask and to understand what someone's experience or sentiment is towards certain days. So I think we've got this beautiful moment where technology can be our friend as we learn about different faiths, and it certainly can, I guess, create those appropriate, sensitive topics of discussion, but make it a bit more of a pleasant experience rather than going in maybe totally in the dark to a conversation about spirituality or religion. I think we can do a little bit of background research and come in with a little bit more sort of religious intelligence.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess as I get older and hopefully maybe a little bit wiser, I find that the more I learn about myself and the people, you know, in my life, you know, everyone's got a story. And I guess it's those moments where you're sharing about your life that you hear other people's stories. And a big part of that can be, yeah, what they believe around the origin of the world and whether there is a God and what that looks like. And even just beyond that, spiritual practices. And we asked in a study, you know, what prompts people to think about spirituality and religion? And the number one answer was a death in the family, followed by conversations with people, followed by health issues of a family member or friend, and personal unhappiness, which, like you mentioned, Jeff, even for your own story, that event that happened to you when you were younger certainly played a part in that. And then, like you mentioned again, you know, your insights and reflections on the experience of COVID and just those 11 a.m. updates that we aren't normally used to thinking about at 11 a.m. on a daily basis in terms of the amount of people getting sick or dying from COVID. So we've had to face that as a society in some ways a bit more maybe from this sort of pandemic experience. So that was something I found quite interesting from the study. Another sort of fascinating piece was we asked about what attracts people to religion and spirituality. Was there anything there that stood out to you, Jeff, in terms of the top attractors to people, I guess, having those conversations that you mentioned that we know people are open to having, but what actually would prompt them in addition to some of those things I mentioned? We also looked at what attracts people to religions. Anything that stood out to you there?
Yeah, it's a really interesting area because I think there are factors that cause people to think and even cause people to change their religion. And so one of the top responses is around when someone shares a kind of a genuine experience of life transformation, that impacts people, that causes people to change. And we asked another question around how do people change, and do some people stay in their same religion the whole life, or do they stop their religion, or do they start a religion, or do they switch? And so, yeah, there's this great new study that you're alluding to a few of the questions. So let me be very clear saying, yeah, there's a new study, The Changing Faith Landscape for Australia is out now. And that's something you can find. It's really designed particularly for Christian leaders to understand the changing faith landscape, but it really focuses on Christianity. And so there is a lot about Christianity in it. So just to set expectations, and this is, I think, where one of the big factors for understanding what impacts people and what might help someone learn about a different faith is that they want to see, does this actually work from a personal experience? And so I think that's a very pragmatic approach. I think spirituality can often be an ethereal, something that's very intangible, but people want to know, does it work? Does this help you? Because as you opened the kind of today's discussion, younger generations are doing it real tough right now, from mental health challenges through to their social isolation and some of the anxieties around interacting with people. There's the impacts of a society that's been pretty unstable during lockdowns and for sort of pandemic restrictions of interactions. And so I think for young people today, doing something that's going to help their well-being, doing something that's going to improve their physical, mental and spiritual life is something we should be encouraging. And so I think that's something to take from this, is that it's an area I think we can in society learn probably how do we encourage well-being when it includes spirituality. And I think probably for some it's that religion's a bit in that kind of dirty sort of, I mentioned before, it's like the brand of Christianity's had a rough go. And so that public sort of expectation or experience might feel a bit eek, but it's also something I think at a personal local community, there are amazing churches, faith communities across Australia. I think there's over 10,000 faith community, Christian churches, plus other kind of faith communities across Australia. So it's something that's kind of one of those hidden parts of society that I think is really helping a lot of people. It's really helping a lot of people. So something I think to consider, how do we look after the emerging generations? And I could go down the housing conversation, and we've done a podcast on that before, but I think there are some very practical things that would help with cost of living, cost of housing, that would reduce anxiety. Stability in the workforce would be another area, as we've got an increasingly kind of gig economy that this generation are growing up in. But I think that access to safe communities is something that we'd want to see more and more young people experiencing. And I'll just personally apologize if you've been to a church and had a bad experience, because sometimes it isn't a safe community and people do inappropriate things, and that's not okay. So I want to acknowledge that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really important. And yeah, I found this particular part of the study really interesting, and we've done some other questions in the past on it. And just, yeah, the top attractors are around people experiencing a personal trauma or significant life change. But the second one I find, again, quite interesting because I've got a little bit of a, I guess, a focus in my role here at McCrindle around storytelling and in presentations. And that was the topic of the TED Talk I delivered. And it was the second one was seeing firsthand people who live out a genuine faith. And I think, yeah, it's oftentimes when we get, like Brené Brown would say, vulnerable with other people and we share our story, like you've shared here on the podcast, Jeff, a little bit of yours, that's when we do get to talk about these topics and we come from a place of understanding going, okay, we might believe different things, but let's talk about those. And the third is philosophical discussion and debating ideas, which is 58% of people say that attracts them to sort of religion and spirituality. So if we can do that in a safe place where we can share our own personal experience, but also maybe have an intelligent debate about what we believe, you know, I think our conversations, our friendships are all the more richer for that.
Yeah, I'm sure plenty of people listening have gone, oh, I've had some pretty unhelpful conversations at Christmas or...
Yeah.
And I think that's the point, is this isn't about trying to force a conversation. This is trying to help raise a interesting discussion. And if it's not of interest for people, I think we need to be really respectful. And this is the interesting part of society, is that one of the questions, I love you dropping a few stats, and oh, I've got to say, if you haven't watched Ash's TED Talk there, you're missing out. It's a cracking TED Talk. I think that's the best way to describe it. 160,000 people would agree with me, I think, was the last count I looked at. Maybe it's more, but it's a brilliant TED Talk about storytelling. And I think this is where people will need to respect that if someone doesn't want to hear a story about faith, spirituality, afterlife, we've got to respect that. And our society is really spread across a spectrum. We're not just in two really polarized camps. One of the questions we asked about Christianity was, what's your attitude towards it? And 30% of people say they identify as Christian. Not a surprise out of 43% that say, yep, in the census I identify. But in our question, it was only 30%, because there's another cohort that are in this warm group. It's people that sort of think, yep, I like the values and I wouldn't probably call myself a Christian, but I like it. And then there's people in this neutral where it's like, oh, that's good for other people to have a faith, but I don't need it. And so it's sort of just in that, it's safe, it's fine, it's good, go for it if you want to, but not for me. And then there's people that are cold to Christianity, and that's 1 in 4. However, out of that 1 in 4, I'll give you the exact numbers here, because I think this is probably one of the most interesting parts of this latest study, is that there's 9% that have some issues with Christianity. There's 13% that have got strong reservations. And then there's 6% that are passionately opposed to Christianity. And so that totals up to 28%, just over 1 in 4 Australians that are cool towards Christianity. Now, that doesn't mean they're cool towards every religion, but I think that's where probably Christianity for some is a little bit on the nose, and they don't want to hear about it, talk about it, see it in society, don't want to see it in the public spheres or in schools. But for a lot of Australians, they're open to the values. They are warm towards it. And so certainly I think it's an interesting spread we've got in society. It might feel like, if you just watch the news, if you're a Christian listening to this, you might feel like there's a lot of negative stuff on the media, but there's a lot of good interactions happening in communities, in schools, where the values of Christianity being lived out, people are being loved, people are being looked after, cared for, served. So I think there's a lot of positive stories that probably don't hit the news, but that's nothing new to say. But I think it's a interesting spread on that question around the attitudes in society today.
Yeah. And again, I guess our purpose is trying to, again, explore this this topic beyond just what the census shows us about sort of, if we compare year on year, what proportion is declining in terms of the proportion identifying with Christianity dropped below 50%. But then we look at attitudes towards Christianity to help churches, you know, engage with their communities. And a big part of what local churches do is serve and support their local communities. And it was heartwarming to see a lot of Australians having positive, you know, reflections about their local church in terms of how they serve and help those maybe who are vulnerable or just running community initiatives. And I guess a big part of not just Christian, the Christianity religion, but a lot of faith-based organisations and churches is building community. We asked a couple of questions in this study, Jeff, about what Australians value about the local church and what the top elements are of thriving communities. Did any of those sorts of top answers there come as a surprise to you, Jeff, or maybe we should share first what they were with the listeners?
I think the top three thriving elements for community were laughter. So having fun together, isn't that a good one that we want to see?
It is good.
Second is ease of conversation. And then thirdly, it was about being inclusive and accepting of others. And so I think that's a really healthy little recipe list there for creating religious intelligence. How do you make it fun rather than being a, we shouldn't be making fun of people, but we should be bringing fun into the topic of our faith and our religion. It's certainly something that is very important. And as you've talked about, it's very private. So I think we do want to have that acceptance, but also that ease of conversation, because it can be quite tricky. And we wanted to make sure we got the tone right even on this. So we were trying to think it through. And it's certainly a topic, I think, that people want to hear about and learn about. And we want to be very accepting and respectful. Now, when it comes to the local church, what do Aussies value about it? Well, top of the list was that it's a supportive community. That was number one. Secondly, it was the social connections. And then thirdly, it's events and programs that support the local community. So when we reflect on those, what do people value about the church in Australia? It's interesting, it's not about that sort of vertical, that spiritual connection. It's actually the social connection. And I think that's one of the powerful things that the church provides. It's not just a faith outlook. It's a religious experience in community. It's about a group of people heading in the same direction. So certainly that supportive community is top of the list, and then social connection. So really curious to, I guess, see how does a church that's shifted into a digital era, or maybe more, a hybrid era, where they're now, I think a lot of pastors are probably scratching their head going, do we keep doing those Zoom meetings or the social media or the live stream now that maybe we can go back into our building or hire that room again? So people, as they look to build community in a digital, hybrid, in-person, I reckon there's a few pastors scratching their head going, what should we do? How should we do that well? So that we can create fun, because Zoom meetings sometimes can't. They're a hard place to do fun. So I think trying to find the right ways to use social media. And I love that one of the coolest stats I think came out that one in two Gen Zs are using TikTok to learn spirituality. That's crazy, because TikTok's all about fun and laughter. And I mean, you don't take yourself too seriously. I think when you put yourself on TikTok as maybe a lot of Gen Zs do, but forgive me, I'm a Gen Y and it just looks like a whole bunch of people having fun. But I think that's probably the thing that religious leaders need to look to is go, how do we engage emerging generations? How do we create a future faith community, be it a church or a different religion, that has that integration of digital and in-person experiences?
Yeah, you've touched on, I think, something that many faith-based institution, churches, leaders, even we've talked about a lot on the podcast, leaders of workplaces. How do we engage and move forward in that hybrid way? It's really not straightforward and it's not easy, because we know that people want the best of both worlds, the convenience and saving time on travel, but then it's not the same when you're on the screen. So how do we sort of meet people where they're at in that regard, whether you're a workplace or a church? So yeah, some challenges there. I think as well, Jeff, as we think about the future of society, and as you've mentioned really helpfully, you know, we've got a multi-faith society that is growing. We're seeing that with the data, with the insights, with the trends, and a growing proportion as well identifying with no religion. What do you see as the future of society and churches in terms of where all this is going? With the data, but also with your personal wisdom and insight, having worked at McCrindle for many years and having looked at all these studies and even the census results over time. Where is the future of this multi-faith society heading for Australia, do you think?
Yeah, this is the. I think this is what becomes really interesting. Where will these trends head to? What does the future look like from that one religious census question? What will the 2026 or the 2031 results be? Will the cohort in Australia who identify with no religion, will that overtake the Christian community? Will it rise above one in two? And I guess that increasing no religion community, will that continue to rise with a cultural mix in Australia that probably does look a little bit more religious than our past migration over the last 50 to 100 years? I think there's going to be a little bit more religious intelligence, as I've described, so maybe there'll be a few more people that are actually comfortable to tick those religion boxes. However, I also, I think that's sort of on one hand, you could have this rising no religion group. I think we could also see that people are open to spirituality. Maybe there'll be more people adopting a spiritual outlook, and even that question might change over time to include people who are spiritual but not religious, people who practice something personally but might not connect with something institutionally or don't want to associate with that that brand institutionally. So I think as we look to the future, we're going to see probably some what might feel like polarizing pressures and forces. However, I actually have a bit of an optimistic outlook in this area, because I think the Australian way of life, we've got the oldest culture and spiritual community in the world living in our society, and we've got some of the fastest growing religions in our society as well. So I think what's curious is, how does spirituality look in a society where we've got two out of five people say no religion, and yet we've got some really fast-growing religions, and we've got cultural diversity that's going to continue to increase the religious population in Australia. And so it will be fascinating to see, what does policy look like around education?
Mm.
What does policy look like around the care of life in those final months and weeks as we wrap up life in those end of days type moments? So I think the care that we provide, the education we provide, the provision of facilities, services, the recognition of the good that's done. I'm very want to be very clear. I know there's been some poor impacts in community from religious organisations, but there is also a lot of good that gets done through charities that are religious. And so I think to make sure that we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater is the very cliched way of saying our society, I think we'll need to find a way to harmonise here. While we might have a few different approaches to faith and people who say, no, I just want science, that's what we've got to learn to build a society around. So that will be fascinating to see, I think, for Australia, with the different spiritual attitudes that we've seen, the changing faith landscape, as we've outlined in that latest report for Christian leaders. So I think there's certainly plenty of interesting conversations, let alone that digital layer, and how do we do better religious intelligence using digital literacy to help equip emerging generations and older generations about the different cultures and religious groups in our society. So I think there's a lot of opportunity. I'm optimistic that we'll find a way forwards without being oppressive, because that's probably the fear, I think, that people of religious backgrounds and faiths have, is that, spirituality and religion is just going to become increasingly private and personal, and you can't practice it in public places, you can't say, you can't tell your boss what religion you are. But I don't think that's the society we want to see in Australia. I think we want to embrace cultural diversity, which means embracing different faith positions. So we certainly want to create a respectful society that's accepting, that's fun. I think if we throw those three things into the mix, that ingredient list, that's a good thing to land on, where we want to see laughter and people having fun together. We want to see an ease of conversation, as well as people being inclusive and accepting of others.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Jeff, for sharing about that. I think you've summed it up really well, really eloquently, with a lot of wisdom. And thank you so much for sharing, again, like part of your personal story in the podcast today, where you're at, a lot of data, but not too much that it was, dry, because it is a really personal topic that we're talking about today, in some ways private, but something that also means a lot to people. And in many cases, they want to share that. And like you mentioned, there can be that fear that exists for people who do identify with a particular religion around how that will be received as a result of things in the media and what's going on in the broader context. So amazing insights, Jeff. Always a delight to have you on the podcast. Thanks for coming on today.
Thanks so much for having me.
And if people would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com. We've got heaps of resources on there. So as always, if you've tuned in for today's episode, once again, thanks for listening, and bye for now.